So this is going to be a little bit of a warlock talk. I guess I found out like I'm a warlock. So this is a little bit like coming to a party and saying, I found a really cool demon I think you guys should check out. So I'm Aaron. I work on a roguelike called Robinson. And I want to share a technique about related to procedural generation. And so I start off, maybe you're like me, you start off with an idea. If you're feeling really like good about it, maybe you make a mock-up of that idea. And then you start prototyping out a generator. And you find yourself, or I find myself in a position where I need some magic. I need some magic numbers. And maybe they modulate some of the randomness. It could be amplifying things. It could be a rate at which some random event's happening. But I need to figure out some magic number, and I put it in there, and the generator works, right? And it's going along, and then it breaks, right? Maybe I changed the generator code. Maybe the game needs to be rebalanced. Maybe I want to add more complexity to the generator. And I think it's hard to pick random numbers. They interact in really weird ways. We might just feel like we want to give up. Like, I'm just not going to have any magic in my generator at all, right? And I don't think that's possible. I took a look at the source code for NetHack, for Crawl, for Angband, for Pixel Dungeon, and it was really easy to find magic numbers. Like, it just took me a minute for like each of those. They're everywhere, and they're not well documented. It's hard to figure out what the intention of the designer was when they picked those random numbers, or magic numbers, rather. So there has to be a better way, right? Like, can we have the computer pick magic numbers for us? It does a good job at other stuff. And I think we can. I think we can have the computer pick the magic numbers for us. And I kind of want to share a way that worked for me to do that. And maybe it'll work for you too. So we need to break things down a little bit. We need to start with our generator. The generator is going to take some parameters. That's going to be like the set of magic numbers. They're just going to exist outside of the generator instead of writing them in place. And the generator is also going to take random input. Instead of calling rand and getting random values inside of the generator, we're just going to pass those in. And the generator is going to do its thing. It's going to produce the output or the artifact of the generator. The second part is we need some way to like score the output of the generator. One idea here, I'm kind of pulling from the machine learning community, is the concept of a loss function. And so a loss function takes the output, in this case, the output from the generator, and it scores it according to some metrics. It depends on really your goals, and it could be a number of things. Some really common or really simple metrics that worked well for me in loss functions were things like density, or connectedness, or like emptiness, or jaggedness. They work really well for like dungeon generation, stuff like that. So we're gonna calculate some metrics on the output, and then we're gonna compare those metrics to target values. How close are they to the targets that we want? And a really simple way of doing that is just subtracting one from the other and just squaring them. And that's pretty straightforward. So I wanna share two generators, and I wanna talk about some loss functions that that score the output of those generators, and then I want to circle around back to optimization. So this is some output from a cave generator, and the way this generator works is it takes a grid of random numbers, and it goes cell by cell, and it adds up all the values of the neighbors, and that becomes the new value in that cell. The magic number, or the parameter for this, is kind of this threshold value. There's just one magic number in this generator. And so we take that new output from that cell, and we subtract this threshold value. We get a new number back, and we pass that through what's called a sigmoid function. Really, all that does is just squash everything down into a range of 0 to 1. It makes it a little bit easier to play with. And just repeat that process like 3 or 4 times, and that becomes the output of the generator. The loss function that I used here was just density. It just counted up how many walls and how many open areas were there. And the target value was 50% And so the generator made things based on those goals. It's about halfway filled in, and it works great. One thing that I didn't consider was connectivity. So the generator and the loss function don't really care about that at all. And you'll see some examples that that aren't fully connected there. This is the output from a second generator that I played around with. The way the generator works is, it takes a grid of random inputs, and it goes cell by cell. It adds up all the neighbors. But instead of giving those neighbors equal weights, we let the weights vary. In fact, those weights are actually the parameters that go into this generator. At the end, we pass everything through a sigmoid function, so it just squashes everything to between 0 and 1. And that becomes the output of this generator. This generator has like 36 magic numbers in it. And so the generator is paired with the loss function. And the loss function here has two goals. One goal is that it wants as few corridors as possible, so it wants really low density. But it's paired with another goal, and the other goal is that we want everything to be as connected as possible. And so the output of this generator is kind of like tree-based in a way. I think that kind of makes sense. That's a really good way to have things as connected as possible, but use as few corridors as possible. It doesn't penalize dead ends, so this generator will produce a lot of dead ends. If I wanted to kind of adjust that, I'd have to add that as another goal in the loss function. But I wouldn't have to change the generator at all. We'd find new magic numbers that satisfied it. So how do we use the generator and the loss function to find those right magic numbers? And so there's a really great kind of algorithm that comes from, it's really used widely in the deep learning and machine learning community, and that's gradient descent. And so the mental model here is kind of like imagining that you're on the side of this really foggy mountain, and you're trying to find your way down the mountain. You know how high up on the mountain you are, so you know your elevation. You can't see very far. You can see the slope just right around you. But you can use that information to orient yourself, and you can walk a little bit, reorient, continue that process until you find your way down the side of the mountain. And that's kind of what gradient descent is going to do. So let's go back to the generator and the loss function. So the trick here is that we have a generator and we have a loss function. We actually need the slope of that. We need slope information. So the question kind of becomes, how can we find the slope of a function? One idea you might have is, well, let's go back to math class. Finding a slope of a function is like finding the derivative of it. And so can you find the derivative of a computer program? And the answer actually turns out to be yes. Like, you can find a derivative of a computer program if it's structured in kind of the right way. That's a programming technique called differentiable programming. For my examples, I used Python. There's a really great Python library called Jax, which is kind of a drop-in replacement for another Python library called NumPy. It's really widely used. It's a numerical processing library. It's really great at taking number values and transforming them in certain ways. That works really great in generators and loss functions too. So let's tie it all together. We need to first kind of pick some starting values for these magic numbers. A good kind of rule of thumb is just picking really tiny random numbers for the magic numbers. That's just kind of a really nice way of getting things started. And we also need a batch of random input. We need a batch of these target values. And the reason why we use a batch of those is because if you just kind of take one example at a time, you're gonna find a really windy path down that mountain. On the other hand, if you take a huge number of examples, it's gonna take a really long time to compute. So there's kind of a middle ground there. In my examples, I used a batch size of 32, and that's kind of where the mini batch idea comes from. Anyways, we take the parameters, our batches, and we use the derivative of this loss function in the generator, we find that slope in that local area that we're interested in, and we use that information the same way we're looking at the slope on the side of the mountain to nudge the parameters in the right way. So we start to converge on magic numbers that tend towards the goals of the loss function. And when we're converged, when we're kind of done with that process, we can take those magic numbers, and we can take the generator and use them in our game or the code that we're writing, and we can feed in as much random input as we want, and we can get these artifacts back that satisfy those properties of the loss function. So we've kind of flipped the problem on its head. We can change the generator, hopefully without being too scared about messing anything up, because we have that loss function, they'll just find really good magic numbers for us. We can also change the loss function. We can change the metrics or like refine it in certain ways and get new sets of magic numbers for the generator that take into account other properties. We can change other parts of the code base and feel a little bit more confident that we're not going to break things. The loss functions with those metrics inside of them are a really good way to sort of document the goals that we're embedding. And that becomes a good way further on in the development cycle when we need to go back and figure out really what our goals were, because they're kind of crystallized in the loss function. So where do you go from here? I used a Python notebook to generate all these examples. That's on GitHub, so feel free to steal that code. It's a really good way to get started. GitHub has kind of an issue with rendering a large notebook, so you might have to hit refresh a few times, but eventually it'll show up. So this helped me look at magic numbers kind of in a new light, and I hope that it helps you as well. Thank you.
Do you want to take any questions?
I would love to if I have time.
Oh, great. We have time for like one or two questions. We'll start here.
Now, I don't know much about this, but I was taught that one doesn't just take arbitrary code and make it differentiable. Could you talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, so there's some constraints there. That's like a whole kind of field that I'm a little bit new to myself. And maybe I'll put it this way, like maybe the proof's in the pudding too, right? Right? Like it did work, yes.
Yeah, good talk. I could imagine finding a lot of those magic numbers arbitrarily also by using a genetic algorithm with a fitness function. Would you care to maybe compare contrast?
Yeah, that kind of thought crossed my mind too. The big constraint that the differentiable programming imposes is that sort of all the numbers have to be continuous. So they all pretty much have to be floating point numbers. But it's very, very efficient at optimizing those numbers. A genetic algorithm, just kind of based on my little experience about it, can probably deal with like discontinuities a little bit better, but it might take a little bit more time to optimize those. Yeah, good question.
Cool, thank you so much.
Thank you.